Hello and welcome to a very, very, very important Facebook Live. I am Johanna Kandel. I'm the CEO and founder of the Alliance for Eating Disorders Awareness. And I could not be more honored and grateful and just so damn happy to be spending some much needed time with my dear friend, Joy, who is just a gift of a friend. And I just am so grateful to spend this time with her. So Joy, I am so, so happy that you're here. I would love to just have you say hello to our attendees first, and then I will share all the fabulous things that are you. But welcome, thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm beyond excited to have this conversation with you.
Thank you. So it's so funny, when I was looking at your bio, I was like, queen, amazing. I can't say enough about you and the fact that you're just sitting there with your tea in your like chair with like your fireplace behind you. It's fantastic. For those of you who are tuning in, Joy is all the things. She graduated from Vanderbilt University with her undergraduate degree in sociology and child development and her master's in clinical health counseling. She comes to our field with a decade of professional experience in working with children, adolescent adults, and their family at all levels of care. One thing that I think is so special and so incredible about you is that you specialize in working with individuals, couples, families around communication, family transitions, including divorce, trauma, depression, anxiety, substance use, disordered eating, and eating disorders. One of the things that I felt so grateful for is when we started to have this conversation several months ago, just your willingness to pick up the phone to have this conversation with me. And for those of you who don't know this about Joy, she is highly sought after by so many advocacy groups around the country and mental health treatment centers. All the important work that you do to consult on multicultural cases due to your personal and professional experiences in managing issues related to diversity, inclusion, lack of inclusion, and other issues related to ethnic sensitivity. Not only does she work as a treatment placement specialist for Acadia Healthcare, but she is a kick-ass private practice clinician. I know your parents are watching, so I'll watch my language, I promise.
But I should have warned them.
So I have a little bit of a potty mouth, but I promise to rein it in for tonight's conversation. But you sent me this quote, and it just embodies who you are. I'm not here to keep you from freaking out. I'm here to be with you while you freak out or grieve or laugh or suffer or sing. It is a ministry of presence. It is showing up with a loving heart. And Joy, I have to share with you that over the last few weeks, as we've been continuing this conversation, you have done that for me. You have allowed me to show up. You have allowed me to ask questions. You have allowed me to be me. And so I just really want to thank you. I also want to start off this conversation by sharing with you and by sharing with those of you who are tuning in that I do know that I'm coming onto this conversation as a cisgender Caucasian female that is able-bodied, that was, had extraordinary privilege. And I think for so long, I've been so inquisitive and so wanting to ask questions and to show up and to help, but I was so afraid to say the wrong thing. I was so afraid to hurt. I was so afraid to offend. I was so afraid. I was so afraid in so many ways that I didn't ask and I didn't show up. And I realize now that by me not saying anything was me not doing anything. And I know personally, I've come to a place where I can't not ask and not show up anymore for the sheer essence of not being afraid that I'm going to say the wrong thing. So more than anything, I come to this conversation with gratitude and fully acknowledging that I may say the wrong thing, but I'm going to ask and I'm going to be aware and I'm going to listen. So more than anything, first and foremost, Joy, how are you doing tonight? How are things? How are you doing? how have the last few months been? I would love to start with that.
Yeah. Thank you so much for asking that. You know, it's hard and it's challenging at times to not only be a helper, but also process at the same time while trying to help so many process just the events of 2020, like mind-blowing what we are all going through. And just as you're talking, and thank you so much for that introduction, I am just so honored that, you know, we're having this conversation. And you and I have been talking for the last little bit, and I've gotten invitations from a lot of different entities. And the question that I often ask, or I have been asking in the last little bit, is just kind of why now? And when you and I first kind of talked about doing this, it was that similar vein of like, why now? You know, is it because it's trendy? Is it because there really is a need? Like, are we ready for this? And so I felt really confident in accepting this conversation that it was going to be honest, it was going to be pure. And most importantly, I feel safe. For so many people who are being asked to speak right now, it's challenging because there hasn't been a lot of safety in work environments in the world, even among our peers. To have conversations as candid as the one that I hope that we have now. So I am okay today. I am hopeful. And I am very much showing up willing to be real as I can. I do identify as being a Black woman, but by no means is my experience meant to be the experience of the world. I work with a lot of clients who come from marginalized communities, who are people of color, who are trying to find their way, particularly working with many clients who have eating disorders and who are people of color and who have struggled to find quality treatment in their communities. And so I come as an advocate using some of their voices as well. And they know that I do this work. They're open to sharing their stories with me so that I can kind of knock on doors and really kind of hold people accountable.
I absolutely love that. And I think, as we've been talking I should probably also share that, you know, I've had the gift of friendship with Joy for many, many years and, you know, through different capacities and, you know, whenever we got to play and, you know, have conversations, it was just so impressive and just so, I've always learned so much from you. And what I really just appreciated the most, I would say, is your ability to show up in all different senses of the word, whether it was, you know, I think my last time in Atlanta when I was speaking, just, you know, going into your car and catching up and just talking about life stuff and just being able to be real and to really share the things that a lot of times is not comfortable. And I wouldn't be authentic and vulnerable by saying that, you know, I come to this conversation with a lot of safety because I entrust, like, you know, our friendship and you provided that for me. And for me, the greatest gift you can give me is by saying that you feel safe having this conversation. So one of the things that we've been talking about is, why do you think that, you know, that there is, I mean, to really like sort of take a step back, is why do you think there's such a lack of access, you know, for people of color, African American, you know, Black folks, when it comes to the treatment of eating disorders? And I know that's a very loaded question, but from your lens, what are some things that you would say?
Yeah, I'm glad that you acknowledge that. It is a loaded question because it means so many different things for so many different people to seek out treatment. You know, when I speak, I often share my calling and my kind of coming into the field. And my parents were phenomenal in being able to sacrifice all they did to ensure that my sisters and I had the education that we did. But therapy was not a part of our culture. It wasn't something that we did. For a lot of people, and particularly for my family, when you're seeking out camp counsel, you're going to clergy or perhaps the elders. of your family. You're not necessarily paying and outsourcing that for a professional. And so when I began, you know, having interest in becoming a therapist, there was lots of questions about what that was. Mm-hmm. And what does that mean? And gosh, from a parent perspective, can you make a living? And so that among, you know, my friends of color, and depending on the culture of their community that they grew up in, therapy and getting treatment just wasn't the norm. And so us in the field as clinicians, you know, I think we have long recognized that eating disorders does not discriminate. It impacts every group of people, all genders, all ages. And we know that. And yet we still see a pretty homogenous treatment milieu. Mm-hmm.
For sure.
So we can definitely talk about barriers. And I think it's something to do with culture. I think it has a lot to do with identification. I oftentimes get calls from parents of like, hey, I just don't even know what this is. I don't even know where to begin. We can go down the statistics on what it's like for a Black woman to present to a physician with the same symptoms as a white female and the likelihood mm-hmm. of them being diagnosed with an eating disorder. That potentially could be a barrier. So it is loaded. And I think that we are doing better in educating the community, but I think we do have a long way to go. And let's not even just talk about it. I feel like this could be an hour-long conversation on this point alone. It's expensive. Treatment
100%.
Is very mm-hmm. expensive. And so coupling all of that together, I really do think that there are some communities that just unfortunately don't have access. I've also heard that people really struggle to seek out help, just not knowing what to expect, not feeling as if the provider will hear them and be able to treat uh-huh. them well. You and I kind of talk about my love-hate relationship with being a therapist that treats eating disorders, but there are people who are seeking out therapists that specifically work with this population, and there's just not enough of us.
Okay.
And it's heartbreaking. And so there's a lot of people for whatever reason who are really not getting the help that they need.
And I cannot agree enough. And I think that, you know, a lot of what I hear, you know, at the Alliance is, well, we're not seeing ourselves represented. We also are not able to access care a lot of times. And then therefore, you know, we've had a few folks that have showed up, you know, to different things that we've done, and, you know, they will share, you know, I don't want to be the only one that shows up. It doesn't feel very safe. It doesn't feel very good. And I think we know that this is absolutely a systematic issue in whole, right? Like, we definitely need to, you know, I think like we need, like, you know, I wish I had a magic wand. I wish I think we could just, you know, we could just change everything overnight. And I know, like, I will talk from the lens of the Alliance is we absolutely need to do better. Like, we absolutely need to be providing, you know, more examples, like having, you know, you know, folks of color, you know, Black clinicians, you know, that are facilitating or more facilitating our support groups, I should say, you know, therefore creating safer spaces where, you know, people feel that they are represented, that, you know, that they can turn around and say, yeah, me too, I understand this, and I, you know, I can see this from a particular lens. Which makes me think, and I will break in and say that my 4-year-old little girl is singing outside the door right now, so you may be hearing her at some point. You know, always to bring levity to any conversation. How did you get involved? How did you get involved in the field of eating disorders? You know, why? I mean, I know that you've done, like, just as that quote said, you've always done such a beautiful job of ministering just hope and support. And I think, what, if I'm not mistaken, that runs in your blood, you know. But why eating disorders? Because, you know, it's definitely not a career that, you know, or a field that many people anyways come to, for sure, you know, clinicians of color.
I mean, honestly, I fell into it. You know, I started the world of mental health. I started my career here in Atlanta, and I had the opportunity to do outreach for Veritas Collaborative way back when. And that's honestly kind of how our relationship started. I got to, for all intents and purposes, we were working when I was doing those business trips down to West Palm, really hanging out with you guys. But honestly, the deeper I got into it, the more I learned about it, golly, it was so hard just to kind of walk away. Honestly, I was reflecting on my time with you guys and really just the impact that you've had on my life, because it really kind of gave me a purpose and a reason and a population to work with. I think sometimes when I show up, it's usually out of necessity, and I didn't know there was a need until I knew there was a need. And it wasn't until I got the education and the ability to consult with people who have dedicated their lives to this, that I realized what a big deal it was. And it really wasn't until about 4 or so years ago where I started getting calls specifically because I was Black. It was the first time in my career that I was listening to voicemails of people saying, hey, I am a person of color and I need this. Is this something that you can support with? That does something to you. Like, it really does. And as much as I try to kind of go in different directions, there's another call that comes, or another provider who wants to consult, or another treatment center that has this case that is just really complex and this kiddo is not progressing. So I definitely did not grow up just knowing I wanted to be a therapist and working with this population. I was an athlete growing up, and so I certainly saw the impact of eating disorders in my sport. But again, it wasn't until I was getting those calls, just hearing the pain and the anguish and really kind of going out there. And as a treatment placement specialist, here I am trying to meet the needs of different people as they're putting these specific requests in my hand, and there wasn't any. I was it. And there are definitely more women of color that treat eating disorders, but if we just kind of look at sheer numbers, there's still not enough of us.
100%. I think I saw a statistic about a month ago that out of, you know, all of the dietitians out there, not even specific eating disorders like dietitians that, you know, that are specialized, I think 1.5% are, you know, are Black. And, you know, when it comes to, you know, the larger therapeutic community, it's very much, you know, one of the things that I hear, and it goes back to all those amazing things that you shared of, like, why isn't there more access to care? Because I think that, you know, for all intents and purposes, you know, it is definitely set up to be, you know, a career that's, you know, seen as, you know, having the privilege of going to school, getting further education, oftentimes, you know, getting doctoral degrees, you know, so much of that. And I just, you know, one of the things why I started, you know, why I started the Alliance 20 years ago was because nobody was talking about eating disorders at the time. And what I wanted more than anything was just for me to be represented. So for me to go out and to say, yeah, like, me too, please, can someone just tell me that I'm not the only one, that I'm not the anomaly, you know? And I think that, you know, that's what prompted me to start this organization. And I think that, you know, I love even, like, our title for this talk is More Than Words, because for me, words are great, but words are only the beginning. You know, we have to follow it by action. We have to, you know, and that is something that specifically, like, that we at the Alliance have been really focusing our efforts on and really making a dedicated and concerted, like, this is what we are showing up. We are aware that we haven't done enough and that we need to do better. There was a question that came in that I would love to ask you. How can we encourage more BIPOC to go into the mental health field? and more specifically, eating disorder care. What systematic barriers do you think we can try to break down? And I think another comment was, you know, it doesn't help that eating disorders have historically and still continue to be, for all intents and purposes, a white girl problem, which absolutely an amazing participant that, which is absolutely not true. So how do you think we can encourage more diversity, more representation in our field?
Yeah, absolutely. And great points. You know, I do speak across the country, and I was doing a presentation in Boston, and to clinicians who were either therapists, social workers, psychiatrists, physicians, and it was eating disorder specific. And so here I am, a person of color, doing a presentation on diversity. And there was a moment where I was standing in front of everyone, and I was looking at about 500 people, and they all could pass for white individuals. And I just had to have a moment where I sat there. I'm like, okay, what are we doing? And so my role is a little bit twofold to the question asker's point. How do we attract more people into this? I think by doing what we are doing now, which is educating the general population, that eating disorders is not just a typical white girl disease. And I would even argue that if we get some representation in some of these treatment centers, we might see a change in who is coming to treatment. If we take a really good look at these barriers, they will come because they are out there. They're just getting lost in the shuffle. So I do, and I would encourage anyone who is interested, I educate a lot of people, even my own nurses and doctors. I had a doctor who made a really negative comment about my health that was not helpful. And I was like, hey, this is what I do for a living. Let me tell you what it sounds like. And if it's someone who looks like me who is presenting in the same way, let's talk about potentially what that language could be like to kind of help aid health, as opposed to kind of steering people away. So any chance that you get, maybe not as bold as you're sitting in the doctor's office and just kind of scolding someone, but we do have to educate people. I really do believe in kind of starting early and taking on individuals who are newer out of their grad school programs, mm-hmm. who might not know what they're interested in, but perhaps need exposure to that. So it is an absolute journey to be able to integrate and really increase the diversity of this field.
I love that. I think that's so important. A question came up earlier just about, you know, that perceived shame about asking for mental health, institutional culture surrounding mental illness, if you will, not being able to reach out. I under no circumstance am I comparing the two or bringing, unpacking my stuff, but, someone who, I have a lot of, transgenerational trauma. My father was a Holocaust survivor. Mental illness was not a thing. We weren't allowed to be sad, be depressed. And it wasn't okay. And I definitely think, very, very similarly, in the Orthodox Jewish community or in the Jewish community, you do go to your clergy, you go to your elders, but you don't talk about there's nothing wrong with you, So do you think that, do you feel the institutional culture surrounding mental illness is a barrier oftentimes for humans seeking help? I mean, definitely we know that representation is a huge, huge, but just the stereotypes around seeking help or the we're just not going to talk about it. We're just going to sweep it under the rug.
Sure. Just speaking from, experience and again, before these talks, I oftentimes consult with some of my other friends, just kind of get their feel. But I think for a lot of people, and particularly people of color, we soldier a lot of things. Yeah. We accept things for how they are. We don't process things the way that therapy hopefully supports, because it's just kind of the way that it is. That doesn't make it right, But we come to a place of kind of complacency that perhaps this is just something that we need to get through or get over. And speaking of, you know, intergenerational trauma, these are the messages that get passed down over and over and over again. And so in some communities, it is seen as if, gosh, I must be crazy before I go to therapy, or some extreme must be happening.
Yes.
So I often tell my clients, you know, maintenance is a lot easier than being in crisis all the time.
I know.
And we can start to kind of shift that way. It is my goal in life to get people to see therapy as if it is a yearly physical. It's something that we do. It should be normalized, like an eye exam. We just haven't gotten there yet. And I think this is our opportunity, especially since the world seems to be a little bit more open to having these conversations, to kind of really allow people the space to be able to think through that or try it out.
Yes. And you know, one of the things that I share all the time is, you know, seeking help is not a failure. You know, I think so often we, you know, we believe that because, like, you know, it's above the net that we should be able to fix it. And that's simply not the case. And then when you're not able to, which you won't be able to, trust me, try it, didn't work. Mm-hmm. You know, it's all of a sudden, then if I failed, I'm not good enough, and it plays into that crappy rhetoric that we carry with us. So I really love, you know, giving yourself an opportunity. And of course, you know, the conversation comes back to you, unfortunately, it's access to care. And so often, you know, something that we talked about is it's very expensive to get treatment, you know, which is why at the Alliance we've been so dedicated to, you know, really offer programming, you know, to the underserved community, specifically our psychological services, where we offer very low cost outpatient care to individuals that are underinsured and uninsured, because I fully believe, and this is the space that I end up in, is that treatment it should not be a luxury. And unfortunately, in the country that we live in the most developed country in the world, oftentimes treatment is a luxury. And so, which is why, you know, 75% of our clients at psych services make an annual household income of $25,000 or less. And it's like, how are they supposed to put food on the table, let alone, you know, get access to care? And so I think systematically we have this huge shift that needs to happen. And again, it starts with conversation, but it has to be followed up with action. And that's what I really hope that we take from this conversation and that we continue to have. I think that's so important. One question that we've gotten repeatedly in the comments is for folks like me, what can we do? What are some action steps that we can do? Again, creating conversations is huge, showing up to conversations. You know, to be willing to, in my mind, my mantra is, you know, shut your mouth and listen a lot and act. So what are some things that we can do?
Yeah. Well, and it's really interesting. There's been a shift in the industry moving from cultural competency to cultural humility. And I think we're kind of in this critical period that now we're kind of looking and trying to expect some action, and we're not quite sure what that looks like. And so what I would say to that is to be really educated as much as you possibly can with the populations that you're serving. As I kind of mentioned before, I am by no means a person who can speak for every African-American experience. Right? That's where kind of cultural humility comes in. So I think it's important to kind of get your regular consultation if you are a clinician who identifies as being white. Have your circle that you can bounce ideas with. And it kind of starts with building that safety and having those conversations. I would not suggest that you ask a random Black person, hey, tell me about your experience, right? There's something to be said for having the relationship with someone and being able to
talk
before them. And that humility piece is kind of recognizing that this is evolving. There is no end to this process. And so what I can appreciate when I speak, and I think this happened right after Malak, Sadie, and I presented for the Alliance a couple of years ago, we always get feedback. And so for those of you guys who may be unaware of what I have done in the past, we actually did a presentation for the Alliance, a couple of years ago, myself and Malak Sadie, who is a dietitian out of Dallas. And we do presentations around the best practices for treatment in diverse communities. And because we typically have limited time, we're only able to cover so much material. And it never fails that we have a person of color who doesn't always appreciate or identify with the way that we paint a particular subgroup of people. Mm-hmm. And so what we've learned to do is make our presentation a little bit more interactive. So this is what we know. And we also would love the input of those people who are with us to be able to let us know what their experiences are as well, recognizing that we have limited time. And so I would absolutely look to get more information on populations, recognizing that we're not going to be able to learn it all. And we allow our clients to inform us on what's important and what's meaningful for them. And that
I love that. And what she's not saying before you continue is a presentation that she did with Folx, who is this brilliant Muslim dietitian. And we do a lot of presentations, highest rated presentation we've ever had. Highest. Okay. There was only standing room and y'all just knocked it out of the park. And what I really appreciated about it is that you shared and then you listened and you created a space for so many people to have safe and comfortable conversations. So I just wanted to, say that it was the best one, the highest you've ever had. So
Thank you. I have an inner critic that has a hard time believing that feedback and will always strive to do better. But, we do that. We get information, we adjust. And I think it was for anybody doing this work and supporting other people, they have to do this work internally themselves. If there's any call to action in this moment, it would be to look inward and figure out where you are in this process. There's no way that we can support somebody else if we aren't grounded in where we are. And that's huge. And we have the time, we have the space, hopefully, in this season to do that before we embark in working with clients who are also processing so much of what's happening now. And then we've got the bigger issue of what we do with the system. It's a hard thing.
Which is, I think that, when you take a step back and look at everything, it can become very, very overwhelming. Like it just really can. And it makes you feel like, well, then why even start? Because are we going to be able to even push the needle forward? And the answer is yes. Our future generations are depending on us doing the things, think about all these amazing, amazing humans that came before us that believe in so much. Like, there's this quote that I come to because, as you know, my heart is, I have the heart of an advocate and I spent so much time on Capitol Hill and it's this idea of do not underestimate that one voice doesn't make a difference and that it doesn't matter. In fact, our future is depending on your voice to show up, to push the needle forward. But I understand how it can become, super overwhelming and feeling, like where do you start? How do you even, where do you go? But we need to, we have to show up. We have to have this conversation, and that's why I think it's just so important. I do have another question. I know that we're going to start to run out of time, but that you and I can talk for hours, which we typically do. One of the things that really stuck out at me when we were planning this conversation is how much work you do with folks that have gone to higher levels of care. That have come out and had to unpack a lot of trauma from that experience. Would you mind sharing a little bit more about that and what, we do have, treatment centers that are tuned in tonight. What are some of the things that we can do?
Yeah, absolutely. I wish I would have had that question a little bit earlier. I have a couple of adolescents that come to mind who really had to work through some trauma. And I've given feedback to these respective facilities, but what is really hard, especially for young African American females and even others that I've spoken with, is sometimes the presentation of their eating disorder is dismissed. And I think oftentimes when we look at the diagnostic criteria, we think of distorted body image as a factor of size. And that isn't always the case. And one particular 10-year-old girl comes to mind when I asked her during an assessment what her ideal body image was. She's like, I wish I was blonde hair, blue eyed. And she had some physical descriptors as well. And there's some of the physical descriptors that are a little bit easier to kind of work with and help an individual process. It's really hard telling a little black girl that she'll never be white and that her hair texture will never be different. And I remember having a family therapy session and her mom mentioning that, hey, like these descriptors have been here, but there was a therapist who looked like the person that this adolescent described. And it was so uncomfortable that they just kind of like washed it, but it was a really important factor.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's really, really important to kind of ask those questions. Don't be afraid to kind of get a little bit deeper and consult when you need to. I think what is really important, especially when we're having conversations around race, when I'm calling for action in treatment centers and asking them to diversify and to bring some representation onto the staff, it does not mean that the staff that is present who is white and perhaps has blonde hair and blue eyes and is the American ideal is not a good therapist. That's not what I'm saying at all. There are just points that happen that may call for a different level of intervention. I do find that sometimes when they feel like they can't find themselves in group therapy, they kind of get lost in the shuffle. And so I think it's really, really important to kind of call attention to that and call attention to even how we are doing some of our groups. The example that I often give is, you know, assertiveness and that training is often given in eating disorder treatment. And we talk about communication styles, we talk about showing up. And we talk about family units and what that means to kind of get your needs met. And if we're not paying attention to the culture of the home, we might be setting someone up for failure, teaching them to be assertive in a way that perhaps is not culturally acceptable. And so I think it's on us as clinicians to do our due diligence and work with the family and understand their unit before we are advising them to do something that perhaps might not be in line with what any particular person is returning home to.
Joy, I think that's so important. I mean, we've had some amazing lives over the last few months, you know, about eating disorders in the Latin American community. You know, we had an amazing live surrounding it. Like there's an amazing human who did a live with us that's Chinese, and she's actually back in China right now, who literally shared, like, you know, some of these CBT techniques and having this conversation with your, you know, having these therapeutic sessions with your parents could never happen because it's a mark of disrespect. And so I think that bringing in the angle of cultural competency is not just it's not just something that we should do. It's things that we have to do because, you know, if we don't, we're going to really approach it from the lens of doing harm. And I know that at the base of it, that's not what we want. We don't want to, you know, we don't want to instill harm. We want to be able to support and help. And so I really, 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 really just thank you for that fantastic, answer. And so as we start to close up, because 45 minutes have like come and gone, and you know, I'm in awe and just humbled by this conversation. What are some just wrap up last words that you want to share with our amazing community that has showed up for this important talk tonight?
Yeah. Well, I first want to thank everybody who did sign on. I mean, just, I am floored and honored and privileged to be with you, Johanna, and just to be able to have this conversation that's so important. 45 minutes does not do this justice. I think that there's just such a need for continued conversation, and hope is that, you know, we're putting it out there and, you know, making it easier for people to go back to their respective communities and have conversations there and spread. Honestly, there's so much heart change that needs to happen in this world. And I think that being able to do this with you hopefully gives people hope that it can be done. I have some really amazing friendships with you and your team. And I'm so honored that through the years and through many different life changes, like, this continues. And so I'm so excited that we were able to do this. My charge to everybody, since this is a call to action, is to go out and have these conversations with people who might not have access to this, and letting them know that there are resources out there. If you guys ever want to connect with myself and Johanna, like, you guys are always available, we're open to doing that. And I'm also really thrilled at some point, hopefully, to come do a training with you guys. That would be a much longer conversation and just an opportunity to keep it going. This is, like I said, it's a lifelong process.
I absolutely love that. And, you know, thank you, Joy, for reiterating the fact that you are available. You are so kind and you are so generous. You know, the Alliance, for sure. There are, you know, some amazing, amazing nonprofits out there. You know, some groups on social. Sad Girls Club is one of my favorite. You know, there's just some just amazing resources. Black Girls Therapy is a great one. We have an amazing list as well that we'd be more than happy to connect you with, and we will do everything in my power, in our power, and my power too. You know, to help connect. You know, I've been so humbled and really, really, really overcome with gratitude, and I know my charge, and I. You know, I am absolutely going to take your charge seriously, and I am going to show up for conversations. I'm going to show up for conversations where, you know, what I have to say might not really be what people want to hear, and I will still go out and have those conversations because, you know, I'm so lucky to have the privilege of being in spaces where I can get educated, that I can ask the questions. And so I feel like there's no question. I have to continue this conversation and put action behind words. So, Joy, we cannot wait to have you come and do. It will be happening hopefully soon, virtually, and then in person at some point. Dear Lord knows when that'll happen. Maybe 2027. Like, you know, I'll have like a 15-year-old by then. God help us all. She'll come live with you. You know, but I just, you know, I really want you to truly know how much I appreciate you, our friendship, your willingness to just, you know, answer my calls. And I really appreciate, like, every time that I pick up the phone to call you, just the grace that you've exhibited, and for allowing me to be an ally. To show up in that space. So we can't wait to have you back down here. But if anybody else needs support, you can absolutely reach out to the Alliance. I'm sure someone will put the information in the comments, in the chat. You know, and we definitely have you know, our free virtual support groups that are Monday evenings at 7:00 p.m. Eastern Standard Time and Saturday mornings at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. If you are in the South Florida community, and if you're not able to get access to care because you are underinsured, uninsured, misinsured, we do have our psychological services. We do have a small wait list, but please reach out to us. We absolutely want to do everything in our power to create access to care. So thank you, Joy. Thank you so much to everybody who showed up tonight for this important conversation. Thank you. But more than anything, I love you with all my heart. I'm so grateful for our friendship. And again, I'm so grateful for this conversation. So have a great night. Take care. and we'll see you all soon. Bye, guys.